Ladies and gentlemen, kindly switch your mobile phones and pages to the silent mode. Thank you for your cooperation. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Hong Kong Shih Yin University, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you. We hope you will find this event to be fruitful and engaging. We are delighted to be supported by the Research Grant Council of the Hong Kong government to launch a three-year institutional development scheme entitled Constructing an Interdisciplinary Research Platform at Hong Kong Shih Yin University. The scheme aims to open up a gateway for promoting interdisciplinary research collaboration at the university. By welcoming more distinguished scholars from all over the world to Hong Kong, we will be able to provide valuable opportunities for local global networking, which will undoubtedly benefit the academics and professionals across different disciplines and geographic regions. This year, Shih Yin endeavors to promote one of its strategic research areas, decision making. We are very honored to have invited a well-renowned expert in international economics, Professor Kar-yiu WONG, to speak at our public lecture. We now invite Professor David Yuan, Head of Business Administration Department of Hong Kong Shih Yin University, to deliver the welcome address. Professor Yuan, please.
Professor Wong, project members, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this public lecture. This year, Shih Yin University endeavors to promote the strategic research area of decision making in this IDS project. We are very honored to have invited a world-renowned expert in international economics, Professor Kar-yiu WONG, to speak at this public lecture. Professor WONG is currently professor of economics at the University of Washington and president of the Asian Pacific Economic Association. And he is the editor-in-chief of China Economic Policy Review and of the Global Journal of Economics. He also serves as editor for Asian Development Review, Journal of Economic Integration, Journal of International Trade, Journal of Asian Economy, International Journal of Economics and Business, Pacific Economic Review, and International Economics and Economic Policy. Professor WONG obtained his PhD in economics from Columbia University and has published extensively in the fields of international trade, economics, and Asian economies. He has authored an acclaimed textbook, International Trade in Goods and Factor Mobility, which has been widely received by researchers in international trade around the world. In addition to contributing research publications, Professor WONG has also organized many conferences and workshops in international trade, economics, economic growth, Asian crises, and industrial organizations to promote research interest in these areas. This evening, Professor WONG will share with us a lecture entitled Judgement in Management Risk, the One Belt, One Road Initiative, Business Opportunities and Risk Management. Let's give Professor WONG a warm welcome, please.
Thank you, Professor Yuan. Professor Yuan, please remain on the stage. I would like to invite Professor Yuan and project member Dr. Bernard Lee to present a souvenir to our speaker, Professor Kar-yiu WONG. I would also like to invite Professor Kar-yiu WONG to come on stage and receive the souvenir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please be seated. It is now my pleasure to invite Professor Wong to share with us a public lecture topic, Judgement in Managing Risk, the One Belt, One Road Initiative, Business Opportunities and Risk Management. Professor Wong, please.
Professor Yang, the program members, especially Jay, and ladies and gentlemen. Well, it's my pleasure to be here, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank Professor Yang's invitation to talk with you about one of the work that I'm working on in something that is very important, not just to Hong Kong, not just to China, but also to many countries in the world, and that is the One Belt, One Road Initiative. Now, before I start my talk, I would like to mention that, Hong Kong is my hometown. I grew up here, and basically I like everything in Hong Kong, except one thing, and that is the food in Hong Kong. The reason is that, every time I come here, I tend to eat too much. I just cannot resist the temptation of tasting more food in Hong Kong. So every time I leave Hong Kong, I would have gained several pounds. And every time I return back to the US, I try to blame myself for not being strong enough to resist the temptation. But now, I would like to take this opportunity to stand up, do some kind of exercise to lose some of the weight that I gained from the dinner tonight. And unfortunately, I just ate too much tonight. Now, the talk that I would like to deliver tonight is about not just the One Belt, One Road initiative, but also some other things related to this initiative. Something about, doing business, making money, and also trying to resist or reduce the risk associated with doing business in some of the countries included in the initiative. Okay. So hope, after tonight's talk, you would know more about the initiative, and in case you are thinking of investing in some of these countries, maybe tonight's talk will give you a big, better picture of what is lying ahead. So the talk here, I'll try to give you a summary of what I am going to talk about. Okay. So basically, I'll try to describe what the One Belt, One Road initiative is, and then I'll try to have a discussion of the economic impacts of the initiative on the countries along the roads and also on China and some of the countries that are not along the roads. And then I'll try to talk about, what kind of business opportunities that we can expect and also how to manage the risks associated with investing in some of these countries. Well, probably you may have heard of the One Belt, One Road initiative many times because it seems to be one of the hottest issues in Hong Kong, in China, and in some other countries as well. So as a result of that, probably you don't need me to repeat some of the things that you have heard before, but I still have to give you a rough picture of what that initiative in order to highlight the economic impacts that I am going to talk about. So, the initiative is a huge project, okay, you know that probably, and it was proposed at the end of 2013, which is, slightly more than 2 years ago. Okay. So it's not too long ago, but within these 2 years, a lot of things have happened. And we can say that, the initiative has already started in some of the countries. So basically, the initiative can be described by the land Silk Road and also the maritime Silk Road. So let's look at a picture, or let's look at a map of what this initiative is about. So the map shows basically, well, the land Silk Road and also the maritime Silk Road. So the land road is about, well, the connection between China and some of the European countries, going through a lot of countries using mainly high-speed railway. Okay, so basically, the land Silk Road is to move people and commodities faster from China to Europe or from Europe to China. And if you look at the land Silk Road, well, basically, it is not just one road, although the English name is one road, but basically, it has many routes or routes, okay? Because, well, there are just more than one way of going from China to Europe, okay? So from here, you can see that, we have the upper path, the middle path, and also the lower path connecting China and Europe. And in addition to that, we can have the maritime Silk Road moving goods and people by sea. Okay. So if we want to describe what that initiative is, well, basically, we just say that the initiative is trying to move people and commodities faster, more directly from China to Europe and Europe to China. But of course, when we say China in Europe, we should not neglect some of the countries in between. Okay, so we have the Central Asia, West Asia, Middle East, Eastern Europe, and so on. So basically, there are altogether 63 countries, or maybe more, okay, in between China and Europe. Okay, and in order to ship people and commodities from one end to the other end, we have to go through these countries. Now, according to at least one article, there are altogether 63 countries that can be identified. But strictly speaking, the number is not fixed because it all depends on how the roads are to be built and how many countries would be involved. So the number 63 is not fixed, but at least for the time being, we can use 63 as the base. Okay, and try to see, well, how many countries would be involved in the initiative. Here I have a table showing, the relative sizes of the countries. And so basically I try to group all these 63 countries into several groups, the Southeast Asia, Central Asia, South Asia, West Asia, or Middle East, Eastern Europe, and even Africa, and also, of course, Russia and Mongolia as well. Okay, so you can see from the table that, their GDPs are of, considerable sizes. In the percentage of the GDP in the world's GDP is also given here. I also showed that China's share in the world's GDP, and you can see something like, 13 to 14%, and out of all these 63 countries, and of course, China's size is the biggest. That is, of course, easy to understand, okay? So you can see that, well, when we say that trying to move goods from China to Europe, so that is exactly what we are trying to say. And the countries in between are much smaller, okay? And as a result of that, the focus is on China and Europe. And after all, that is the original idea of the Asian Silk Road, okay? So we are using that term here to describe the objective of this modern Silk Road. Okay. Okay, now, in order to have a better understanding of this initiative, here I use a diagram, okay, a graph, simple graph, to show exactly what we may expect for each of these 63 countries. So here, you can see that, I try to count the event starting from 2014, because the initiative was proposed in November, October, and then November of 2013. So we forget about the 1 or 2 months in 2013. So I start counting in 2014, and now we are somewhere here. So this is where we are, right here. And zero would be the starting point for a particular country when a high-speed railway would be built, okay, and or a seaport would be built, and then it would take about 3, 4, or even 5 years, you know, to finish the high-speed railway or the seaport. So I put 3+ somewhere here, okay, that signifies the end of the project. Okay, so roughly speaking, we can have stage one here, and stage two, and stage three, depending on where we start, we begin the project, and where we end the project. Okay, now this would be useful for us in analyzing the economic impacts and also the business opportunities, something that I'm going to describe later. Okay, now these three stages actually have names, or at least I can give them names. Okay. Stage one would be the stage in which we start promote the initiative, and we would have the Chinese government negotiating with some of the governments of some of these countries. Okay, so that this is the stage when we have promotion and negotiation. And then in stage two, we have the construction of the facilities. As facilities here refer to the high-speed railway, and also seaports, airports, roads, logistic facilities, and so on. Okay. And then when we start finishing the construction of the project, then we would enter stage three. Now, stage three is the post-construction stage. Now, this stage would be very important when we talk about the economic impacts. Okay, the reason is that stage three would cover the time after the completion of the facility, and it can go on forever. So it can cover 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. So starting from stage three, the economic relations between China and these countries and also Europe would be entirely different. Now I'll talk about that later. Okay, okay, now we are in the promotion and negotiation stage. Okay, so basically it would be a stage carried out by the Chinese government. Okay, so if you pay attention to what the Chinese premier would be doing when he visits some of the countries, then you know that he is not just the premier of China, but also the salesperson of high-speed railway for China. Okay, so every time he goes to a new country, then he would try to promote the high-speed railway. Okay, now that shows this is the top priority of China in establishing and in improving the economic relations between China and some of these countries. Okay, and this is a stage carried out mainly by the Chinese government. So in some sense, that is not too much that we can do, and not too much we have to worry about. Okay, now, China, or at least the premier of China, okay, when talking about the high-speed railway with some of these countries, he actually received a very warm welcome and high interest in building up the high-speed railway in their own country. Now, why is that? Okay. Now, China has some assets. Okay. When promoting this high-speed railway, first one is the track record. Okay. Now, if you pay attention to the high-speed railway, and of course, the Hong Kong is the southern end of a line going to Beijing. Within the 10 years, so basically, China built up a huge network of high-speed railway in China, and that is a world record. Okay, and now the length of the entire high-speed railway network in China is more than what the total length of high-speed railway in the rest of the world. So actually, China's network occupied around 60% of all the high-speed railway in the world. Okay, now that's one thing. Another thing is that, I'm not sure whether you are aware of that, the longest bridge in the world is in China, and it is part of the high-speed railway between Shanghai and Beijing. Now, that is the longest bridge in the world. And how about the second one? Also in China. And how about the third one? Well, also in China. And all these three bridges were built in the last 10 years. Okay, so within 10 years, China has established a lot. Okay, and when China wants to convince other countries to build similar high-speed railways, China can show its track record and can show its experience, can show its achievement to other countries. Okay, and later I'll go over the Indonesian case showing a successful story of China. Okay. Later, okay. Now, and of course, China not just the experience, but also money. Okay. Now, because of this, China set up the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank with a total capital of 100 billion US billion dollars. Okay, now that is not very much money, but it's still a lot to me. Okay, but at least that can be used mainly for the construction of high-speed railway and seaports. Okay, in Asia. Okay, and so that is why when other countries have heard about the high-speed railway. Well, they are thinking of getting the money from the AIIB. Okay. Well, in fact, China was never shy of saying that the AIIB is related to this One Belt, One Road initiative. Okay. Now, in addition to that, China established the Silk Road Infrastructure Fund. So China put up a big sum of money, $40 billion, okay, particularly for establishing infrastructure for the Silk Road, okay. So that is why when other countries have heard about this, they would try to convince China to come to them first, okay, because they know that, China is not having just empty words. But with experience and money in the pocket, now that means a lot. Okay. Okay. Now, in fact, if we read newspaper articles, we can see that actually many countries have been showing great interest in the initiative. Okay. Today, I just read one article describing Vietnam's interest in the initiative. Okay. Now, why is this news strange? Okay, or very interesting. The reason is that China. You may heard that Vietnam has been has been against China in many things. Okay, not just the south in the South China Sea, but in other things as well. So initially, Vietnam didn't show too much interest in the initiative. And if you look at the map of Southeast Asia, you can see that China has the plan, a grand plan of building a railway network from Kunming in Yunnan, going down to Singapore, So trying to build a railway network going down to Singapore. Now, if that has been completed, all these countries, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Cambodia, Laos, Vietnam, and also Myanmar, would be connected economically to China. Initially, Vietnam was not too, or at least didn't show much interest. And in fact, one of the railway lines going from Yunnan to Singapore is to pass through Vietnam. But that part has not been started, and we are not sure whether Vietnam would like that kind of construction. So far, we have a railway line from Yunnan to Laos, and Thailand is trying to build the second foot of the line before going from Bangkok to Singapore. Now there's also a west line, passing through Myanmar. Now, today's news is that Vietnam at least expressed an interest in having such a rail line going from Yunnan to Singapore. So what we can see is that actually people, countries, have been showing various interest in having the initiative, in having the high-speed railway going through their countries. Now, unfortunately, I don't have time to collect all these information which exists piece by piece, so you need to have some time, some people to collect relevant information. Now in stage two, we have the construction of the high-speed railway. That means we have to inject money, investment money, into the country. So suppose that we are talking about, say, Kazakhstan, which is on the western part of China. So we want to build our high-speed railway through Kazakhstan. Now, Kazakhstan, we have already a railway, but it is a low-speed railway passing through Kazakhstan to Europe. But if we want to have this initiative, we may have to build a new railway using high-speed trains. Now, if you want to build such a new railway, we have to invest money. And then the money would come probably partly from the AIIB and partly from the Silk Road Infrastructure Fund. No matter where what the source is, we would expect that we have to inject money into the economy. Now, that means that the local economy is going to receive some form of foreign direct investment. That should be good for the local economy. Now, I'll talk more about that later. And the technical side, of course, would come from China's technology. Now, that is something we don't have to worry about because that's nothing I know about. But in addition to the construction of the railway lines, we would have big demand for other associated commodities. Something like, say, a screw, okay, or a chair, or something like that. Well, in order to complete the construction of the high-speed railway, we need a lot of things, okay? Now, of course, the part of the things will come from China, but part of the, some of the parts may come from some other countries. Now, if the money comes from AIIB, there has been a saying that all those investment projects would give priority to the members of the AIIB, okay? Meaning that, well, if you are, have a country in, say, in say Germany, okay, maybe you would have received some kind of priority as a supplier to some of the goods needed for the construction of the rail lines. Okay, and that is in fact one obvious reason why so many countries are interested in being a member of the AIIB. Now, if you go back to last year, to or actually maybe more than 1 year ago, to see how the AIIB was formed, you will see that well, initially the response was not that big. And the story was that well, the U.S. has been trying to discourage some of the countries from joining the AIIB. And then toward the end of March last year, many countries tried to join in and to become the founding members of the bank. Okay, and Germany was the, well, joined the bank within the, in the last week of May of March. Okay, now one probably one reason why they are so much interested in being a member of the AIIB is that well, their companies would receive some kind of priority in supplying parts and materials and products to the projects financed by the AIIB. Okay, and as a result of that, well, if you have a company in one of these countries, then probably you should pay attention to what is going on in the AIIB and also in the initiative. Okay, now here, let me give you an example, a case study of what may happen in the future for some of the countries when China is building the high-speed railway. Okay, and that is the Jakarta Bandung line. Okay, the line is an interesting case, although actually, that line is not part of the Land Silk Road because, well, Indonesia we are talking about the Java Island of Indonesia. It is away from the Land Silk Road. So this is not part of the Land Silk Road, but this can show what we can, what we may expect from future high-speed railway to be built.